My cousin Sasha had lived in the desert for 20 years before I discovered she had become an artist. I was looking at her kids' social media stories, as I often did with people I used to know, to see how they'd aged and try to gauge their happiness, when I saw a post from her son, proud of my mom, with a link to an article about Sasha in Art News. The picture showed dozens of hot air balloons suspended above rambling, colorful sculptures stretched out across the California desert. According to the article, Sasha made these forms out of discarded plastic. Later, she melted the sculptures down to create compressed bricks that had been displayed and sold, along with aerial photos of that same plastic in sculptural form at art galleries. Sasha, what the hell? If anyone had required proof that life's outcomes are impossible to predict, this development would have supplied it. Sasha had been a fuck up all the way into her 30s, a kleptomaniac who'd managed to pilfer countless items from countless people over countless years. How did I know? Because right before she married Drew in 2008, she started returning things. Everyone in the family received an item or two, sometimes of so little value that it was amazing Sasha remembered what belonged to whom. My dad got a Bic pen, the kind they sold in bags of 20 at Staples. I too received a pen, but mine was a Mont Blanc worth several hundred dollars. I nearly had a brain hemorrhage when it vanished after a family dinner at a Korean restaurant while I was visiting New York. I'd phoned the restaurant, the taxi authority, the MTA. I'd retraced my steps through Koreatown, bent at the waist to scrutinize gutters. When that very same pen showed up in my mailbox a couple of years later with a handwritten note that began, "Since my teenage years, I have struggled with a compulsion to steal, which has been a source of great anguish to me and of loss and frustration to many others," I called my dad. "I know," he said, "I got a Bic. I'm not even sure it's mine. It might have belonged to the restaurant." "Can we please be done with her, Dad?" I asked. "Once and for all, she's incorrigible." "She's the opposite of incorrigible," he said. "She's making amends." "I don't want her amends. I want her to disappear." "What makes you say things like that, Miles?" I remember exactly where I was standing when we had that conversation, on the deck of the lakeside Winnetka home Trudy and I had over-leveraged ourselves to buy. She was pregnant with Polly, our first, and painstakingly decorated together, the site of a planned domestic idyll of children, holidays, and family reunions that we'd rapturously envisioned since meeting in law school at the University of Chicago. Holding my phone, looking out at twinkling Lake Michigan, I understood with sudden clarity that doing the right thing, being right, gets you nothing in this world. It's the sinners everyone loves, the flailers, the scramblers, the bumblers. There was nothing sexy about getting it right the first time. Fuck Sasha, I thought. I'm fully aware that Sasha emerges from these descriptions as sympathetic, whereas I come off as a moralizing prig. I was a moralizing prig, and not just toward my cousin. My father, who treated Sasha as a daughter and whom I saw as her enabler. My mother, whose romantic adventures since my parents' divorce I found sickening. My younger brothers, Ames and Alfred, both of whom I deemed lost before they turned 25. No one escaped the roving, lacerating beam of my judgment. If anything can be said in defense of the person I was in 2008, the year Sasha made amends and Polly was born, the year I turned 30, it can only be that I was least forgiving of myself. Every move I made was aimed at harrying myself toward greater excellence. But certain things, like sleep, resist rigid control. In high school, my insomnia had made it possible to excel academically while playing three varsity sports, working for a tree pruning company, and pleasing a finicky girlfriend. I bridged the gaps with peanut butter, which I ate by the jar, and teenage energy. But Polly was colicky, and by then I was the youngest partner in my law firm's history, and the workload was crushing. I started taking sleeping pills at night and Adderall in the morning to get me going, and eventually throughout the day to keep me sharp. When the Adderall made me jangly, I'd calm down with Xanax or Percocet in the afternoon before knocking myself out with more sleeping pills at bedtime. I saw this metabolic tinkering as nothing more than taking care of business, and the ease with which I chemically managed my deficits, coupled with a slight drug nausea I often felt, made me doubly impatient with everyone else. I became, as they say, irritable, hard to work for and harder to live with. My high standards intensified the pressure I felt personally, which meant that I wasn't home with our kids enough, 3 and 5 years in keeping with our plan, or much of a partner for Trudy, who had suspended her law career to enable our child rearing sexually or in any other way, all of which made me more irritable because I sensed that I was failing when all I had ever done my entire life was try to succeed. To the naked eye, things still looked fine at that point. I was bringing in business and seeing it through, albeit at the cost of some popularity at my firm. At home, everyone seemed happy, as I reminded myself daily by checking Trudy's Facebook, later her Instagram feed. She was a genius at capturing offhand moments and making them look iconic. Scrolling through her trips to the beach, the park, the zoo, often with our neighbor Jana and her 4 kids, ice cream dribbling from chins, a video of crayon pinwheels twirling in the breeze, I could actually feel my heartbeat slow, my blood calm. Any fragment of time I'd managed to rest from work and spend with them was always front and center, and I gorged on Trudy's shots of Polly hugging me, of Michael, our older son, throwing me a ball, of me spooning mashed bananas into the mouth of Timothy, our baby. Everything was fine, I told myself, drawing deep breaths at my cherry wood desk in my towering glassy office. They were still there, still happy. We were happy, all 5 of us, in our beautiful home by the lake, exactly as Trudy and I had fantasized after making love between law school classes, just waiting for me to come back. I'll stop there.
That was fabulous. Thank you for that reading. You know, there's so much that this book is about. You describe the one of the themes as being perspective. You know, this wonderful structural tactic you've hit on of different POV characters in every chapter gives you a lot of scope to roam over a lot of themes. But one theme that is, I think, very central to it is memory and nostalgia. I think it's not a spoiler to say that the MacGuffin of this book, approximately speaking, is that people can upload their memories and access each other's memories. And there's a lot of kind of, you know, panopticon nostalgia where you're like remembering how other people remembered the things that you kind of remember and remembering your own stuff. This is definitely a weirdly nostalgic moment we're living through. We're, you know, we've spent the last couple of years locked indoors, spending a lot of time remembering what things were like before we were locked indoors. And that's without throwing in, you know, Spotify with all the music ever recorded and all these other ways of like being extremely atemporal in your approach to the world. And I wondered what you thought about nostalgia and its both productive and toxic character. My friend John Hodgman says nostalgia is a toxic impulse, but he says that because he is always being nostalgic. And so he's flaying himself. Do you struggle with nostalgia? Do you luxuriate in it? What are you saying about nostalgia with the book?
Well, I have 2 relationships personally to nostalgia. One is I use my memory / craving for times and places from my own life as a portal into fiction. It literally is my entry point. So I draw heavily on a kind of body and sensory memory of all kinds of details of a moment that I'm using for my own life. And I don't know if I would have such a strong sensory memory of moments and times and places if I weren't inclined toward nostalgia. There's something almost inherently nostalgic about that kind of remembering. So I need nostalgia. I think that's the first thing I'll say. But the other thing is I do have a lot of wariness of it. And in a way, it's very bound up with image culture and mass media always, because an image is a presence, but also an absence always. you're looking at something, so there's something there, but that something is not there. So images inhabit, embody a paradox. And I think we're so flooded with images from our own lives via social media, even if we don't participate directly, we're sort of represented either way. And those images are inherently nostalgic. An image from 10 minutes ago is nostalgic. It's a moment that's gone that I'm now remembering. And you know, this is, it becomes very clear when we're remembering a person we've loved who's gone. But I'm really struck by how painful looking at pictures of my kids when they were littler can be, because there's an inherent hunger or yearning to that kind of image consumption, even though it's kind of celebratory, like knock wood, they're alive and well. So nostalgia is just part of the bargain of thinking about image culture and mass media and how it impacts our internal lives.
And do you think that the speed at which everything is happening, whether it's climate emergencies or political destabilization or the fact that 60,000 new songs are uploaded to Spotify every month, or that there are more books being published than at any time, that there being so much coming in makes us feel like we've just missed something and makes us want to look back because a whole bunch of stuff shot by while we were like dialed into something and we want to know what we missed?
Yes. I mean, I think I'm struck by the fact that a person of any age feels like the person 3 or 4 years younger than they are is more technologically savvy and plugged in than they are. So when I wrote A Visit from the Goon Squad, which is very much about time passing explicitly and directly inspired by Proust's In Search of Lost Time, I thought, okay, this is a book for middle-aged people. I'm just going to accept that, because who the hell cares about time passing when they're under 35? I was so wrong. For some reason, young people related to this feeling of time passing to a degree that I never would have expected. So I think we are inherently feeling outmoded all the time because of technology. And I think that the speed of change is really part of that.
There's a wonderful book on this, James Glick, who wrote Chaos and was a very beloved international bestseller, enjoyed his newfound fame. And among other things, he took up flying ultralights, and he crashed an ultralight and killed his 12-year-old son and lost his leg, and spent 3 years at the start of the dot-com bubble, which he'd been really sort of integrated with as one of these kind of techie types, 3 years in rehab and missed it. And he came back and wrote this book called Faster about the change in tempo that he was only able to notice because of the 3 year break. And it's a book that gives you goose pimples, but it's also a marvelous nonfiction account. So speaking of eternal verities and themes that are universal and that are very present in your book, there's a lot of people using technology to try to understand themselves in your book. And that's not a new impulse. You know, we have the Temple of Apollo at Delphi, know thyself. And yet there seems to be something different between like mindfulness meditation and wearing a Fitbit. They're really different kinds of ways of knowing yourself. And it felt like you have an uneasy relationship with this. Is that something that you're trying to explore in the book?
Well, I love the contrast you just invoked. I mean, the Fitbit is a way of knowing ourselves through data, and that is a form of knowledge that is ever increasing and certainly reveals truths. I mean, we are predictable in lots of ways. We are categorizable. If we weren't, the multinational corporations who are profiting from our data wouldn't be paying for it. So it obviously works. But of course, we know individually that we are unknown. I mean, it's a fact of our existence, no matter how much we might try to share. And that impulse is very strong, not so much in me, but in a lot of other people. We can rip ourselves open, but we are still hidden. We cannot get around that solitude. So I feel like one of the paradoxes that really led me into this book is the contrast between the kind of knowing and knowledge that data provides about human beings and human behavior, which is real, and the essential mystery and unknowability of individual humans, and therefore isolation.
an excellent and thought-provoking answer. To the audience, I just want to remind you that in about 20 minutes, we're going to go to Q&A. And you have that little Q&A link at the bottom of your Zoom window there if you want to click on that and type some questions. And I'll remind you that a long rambling statement followed by what do you think of that is technically a question, but not a good one, unless you're the moderator. And then you're allowed to do those. So Jennifer, you raised the kind of prospect of privacy, which is of course another theme in the book and in the milieu that you're you know, exploring. And I'm minded that, you know, Ed Snowden talks about privacy as an essential for social change. He says, you know, how do we get from the point where like it was a felony to be gay to it's embarrassing that it was a felony to be gay in one lifetime? It didn't come because all of the gay people were suddenly outed and everyone just had to confront it. It came because gay people could speak their truth to the people they thought they could build alliances with, each other and their loved ones, and choose the time and manner of the disclosure to build the movement that led to the social change. And so unless you think that in, you know, 50 years, your grandkids are going to say, tell me again how in 2022 we solved all of our social problems, there's probably someone who has something they're not telling you that matters to them and that should matter to you. And I wonder, you know, this idea that people give up privacy so readily in your book. You know, the bargain is in part that if you upload your memories, then you make them part of a cloud. And there are obviously people in your book who sharply regret this and people who think that those people are foolish and so on. I wondered, you know, where you come down on this and what kind of ambivalence you were expressing there.
Well, what really, so there are two phases to the invention, which by the way, I've been reminded multiple times was a Black Mirror episode. So this is not, I did not invent new sci-fi technology here and I would never presume to do so. I'm much more interested in lived experience amidst technology. So there's a cube that you can externalize your consciousness onto for your own personal use. And there are lots of reasons to do it. I would be tempted. First of all, I'm positing that if you have a traumatic brain injury or begin to encounter dementia, you can reinfuse healthy consciousness and be cured. So the analogy would be a woman freezing her eggs, let's say, at a young age, just as a hedge against later infertility. Also, I'm very aware of how little of my memory I really have access to. I go over the same points again and again in my memory, and they're often linked to images, interestingly. In this case, it would be images from our photo albums that my mother used to make. So there's suddenly this wealth of experience to reconsider from an adult perspective, and that's very interesting. As an ancillary possibility, people can share all or part of their consciousnesses, i.e. memories, to a collective, which they do. It is a give to get arrangement. If they want access to this collective, if they want to indulge their curiosity about looking out through other people's eyes, they have to share. That's the bargain. And we make that bargain every day. You know, we do it with DNA analysis. If you want to find out if you have any relatives out there, you have to make your own DNA results available. So it's a pretty exact analogy. Curiosity is a really powerful force because it is about instant gratification. Unintended consequences always come later. And so I absolutely understand why people would do this. And people have said to me, well, could this actually happen? Is this really possible? I think the answer is no. We don't understand the brain well enough, or even a little bit enough, to create a machine that could externalize consciousness. I think the reason it feels imminent is that it's already happened. This is what the internet is. It is a collective consciousness that's full of so much information. A curious person can find out way more than I think most of us would believe by spending a little time on the internet. And we've already made that bargain by indulging our own curiosity, our desire to share, our desire to connect at the cost of our information.
Yeah, I think that's very well said. Luna, thank you for, and also Maria, thank you for putting questions in the comments. If you want to put them in the Q&A, that's a little easier for me to manage, but either way is fine. Speaking as a science fiction type science fiction writer, I hereby forgive you any similarities to Black Mirror episodes, because I can tell you that every Black Mirror episode is derived from you know, sometimes dozens or even, you know, many dozens of science fiction stories and novels that predate it. And ideas are easy, execution is hard, and you know, there's nothing new under the sun. So I wouldn't worry about it in the slightest. You're fine.
I feel absolved. Thank you.
You're fine. Yeah. Go forth and sin no more.
Or keep sinning.
Yeah. Or keep sinning as much as you'd like. So you bring up the issue of refuseniks, and you have a segment of the book devoted to a special kind of refusenik and the counter refuseniks, the people who are trying to neutralize the refuseniks. And that's obviously a thing that's alive and well today, right? So you have some people who just try not to use the devices. I know some people with like flip phones kind of make a fetish of it. It's kind of a big deal. It's like being a vegan or something. It's like not enough that you have a flip phone. Everyone has to know that you have a flip phone. But there's also some other interesting things going on, right? So there's a lot of counter algorithmic work going on. There's a company called Para that lets DoorDashers hack the DoorDash app, which hides the full compensation until you've done the job, because DoorDash wants you to do unprofitable jobs, because that way they get happy customers who don't have to spend a lot of money. And the Para just shows you the full amount on offer before you take the job. It unwraps the offer and shows you the hidden value. There's a lot of counter-algorithmic work. There's another one, Algorithms Exposed, which they have a plugin that will track how things are being recommended to you on YouTube and Facebook and TikTok and I believe Pornhub, and then they are now making alternative recommendation systems. But in between, what they're doing is building a list of the forbidden words and phrases and activities that are getting people who make materials for these platforms downranked or banished because the service won't tell you. And so this idea of like counter algorithmic work, you know, seizing the means of computation versus opting out, I think are both on display in your book. And, you know, I know which one I think more of, and I wondered where you landed on this.
Well, in a way, I sympathize with all of them. I mean, that is the job of the fiction writer, empathy is the chief tool. It has to be. And if I can't empathize with a point of view enough to understand why the decisions of that person feel essential and inevitable, then and if I can't make that available to the reader, then I'm creating characters who are simply alienating and I'm not doing my job. So who knows, but I will say, so the refuseniks in this book are called eluders, and they are people who have decided that not only do they not want to externalize their consciousnesses or, God forbid, share them to the collective, but they are unable to live with the degree to which they're already represented in the collective through all of the other points of view that have been shared. And again, the analogy would be, you know, whether you or I have actually had DNA analysis, we are totally findable simply because of the number of North Americans who have had their DNA analyzed. It's kind of amazing. I mean, and so it's an exact analogy to that. So the eluders really only have one way out, and that is to exit from their identities altogether. And one character likens it to an animal chewing off its leg to escape a trap. It's a very high price to pay, giving up your self and assuming another identity. But that's not enough, because you can't just disappear. Everyone will know you're gone. What you have to do is hire a proxy to impersonate you online so that no one knows you're gone for quite a while. And proxies, a cheap proxy is just a program that is sort of using your online material to try to generate more. But the really good proxies, and I have to say I had a little fun inventing this, are fiction writers, because they're good at impersonating people. And so being a fiction writer, our job is to emulate the online discourse, behavior, buying habits, and general output of people who have eluded, so that only people who would have expected to see them in real life even know they're gone.
I love writerly jokes about writers. I know it's a little inside baseball, but like there's a bit in 1984 where Winston Smith first sees Julia, and she's walking down the hallway with a giant wrench and she's covered in grease and she's come from servicing the novel writing machines. And every time I read that, I'm like, oh, George, you're not a machine. It's fine. You're doing real work, you know?
Oh, that's so funny. Well, you know, one of my money jobs was a private secretary to a woman whom I impersonated a lot.
Oh, wow.
And I think one reason I was able to do that successfully was just because of general, you know, fiction writing skills and, you know, mimicking dialogue, mimicking sense of humor, et cetera.
Yeah, I mean, and I think the other extreme of that, you know, not Orwell being self-effacing, but the self-aggrandizing one that always gets me is Hamilton, where you have, you know, a writer, Lin-Manuel Miranda, who tells us the story of this guy who was like a tactician and founded a university and a newspaper and did a bunch of other amazing things. But really what he did was write. Of all the things he did, that's the thing that he should really be. He wrote his way out. He was just a great writer, and all that other stuff was just like, it was a side hustle. So you said earlier something that caught my attention, that we are in some way like statistically predictable, which I think is indisputable, and that's why the advertising stuff works. And there's a pretty hot debate going on right now about how to understand those facts. So like, there's a guy, Lee Vinsel, who's a you know, critical text studies guy, who coined this term critahype, which is when you say Facebook is an existential threat because they're evil geniuses who figured out how to build a mind control ray. And it was used, you know, originally to sell your nephew fidget spinners, but now Robert Mercer has it. He's making your uncle a QAnon. And, you know, I think Facebook kind of likes that story, because if they're going to be evil, at least they get to be geniuses. Plus, like, if they can sell your uncle QAnon, then why wouldn't anyone pay to advertise on Facebook? Clearly they're very good at their job. And you know, then there's the other one, which is that, oh, they've lied about every single thing about their business. It seems unlikely that the only place they're telling the truth is in their sales literature. Maybe they're lying about how well their products work too, and people are just buying their services by the billions, for the same reason that people give money to money managers who underperform the S&P 500 by the billions. You know, they're just good salespeople. And I wondered, again, like, having written a book about the venality, lack of self-awareness, and absolute lack of good relationship with the truth of the tech sector, where you think this mind control debate should lie?
Well, I should first say that, you know, I don't really see tech that way. To me, paranoid visions are almost wonderfully easy. Wouldn't it be simple if there were just an evil mastermind that we needed to eliminate, like in James Bond movies? That's not how it works in my experience. Most people feel that what they're doing is good. And in my experience, maybe it's rationalization. You know, it helps a lot to tell ourselves that what we're doing matters and is going to make the world better. But it is much more complicated to try to dismantle an apparatus that I do feel is actually potentially very harmful in multiple ways when it's being assembled with the best of intentions. And Bix Boughton, my inventor who invents the consciousness cube, we learn later that over the course of his later career, he becomes appalled by what has happened and the fact that the collective consciousness, which he saw just as a kind of sideline that would be good for solving crimes and things like that, that it's become the main thing, and he, we learn toward the end, is actually supporting an organization that is trying to undermine the very thing he created. So I'm much more interested in those contradictions and the ways in which intentions are subverted by use and reality, which is even the case with a book. You put it out into the world with certain ideas about what it is. Guess what? Not everyone sees it the way I do. And that is part of the process. They're not wrong. They're reading a book and this is what they think it is. Who am I to tell them it's not true? So that's much more what interests me. So if I only saw evil geniuses, I probably wouldn't be moved to write about it, because to me, that is actually kind of generic and not that interesting narratively. Back to your question about how I actually view this tech industry, the current existence of corporations that trade in our attention, basically in which systems in which we are the products, but it took a very long time for us, or certainly for me, to understand that. I think it's really worrisome for a number of reasons, because I actually do think that there are big reasons that tech and social media in particular has a lot to do with the divisions in our country. We all know that negativity in quote unquote engages much more readily. And so the system is skewed toward negativity mathematically. That's not an opinion, it's just a fact. How can that be good? We've allowed into our communication a third party that is supposedly providing a neutral enabling device for that communication, but in fact is skewing our communication toward division and negativity. That's really unhelpful. It would be as if a telephone, for reasons that had mathematical underpinnings, made conversations become arguments and angry fights. That would not be a very helpful communication device, but that's where we are. So I think that's concerning.
Yeah, I think that's well said. There's a guy who lives around here called Tom Jennings, who's done a lot of amazing technology things, but one was that he created a system called FidoNet, which was a way of linking up local bulletin board systems before we had internet access. And he told me this amazing story about how in the early 80s, there was this recurring argument he had to cool out among FidoNet users, whose structure was, how dare you come into my living room and talk to me that way? And he had to spend a lot of time explaining to people that just because you're in your living room hearing it, the person who's saying it to you is not in your living room saying. And, you know, then Bill Gibson coined the term cyberspace. And I guess we found another way to think about all of this. And, you know, speaking of your people interpret your books differently, as Gibson has said, cyberpunk is a warning and not a suggestion. So we're getting pretty close to audience questions. But before we get there, I just wanted to give you a chance to talk a little bit about how you came to write the book and also its relationship to the previous volume. All the reviews have been at pains to say that one needn't have read Goon Squad to appreciate this book. I think that's entirely true, and I assume you agree. But if you could just say a little about Goon Squad in this book and how it came to be.
Sure. I mean, you know, the nature of these books is that there are a lot of things I try that don't work. You know, that I'm always trying to use more unusual structural approaches. Those only work if I can find the story that can only be told that way. And what that means is there's a lot of trial and error. So with Goon Squad, there was a lot of material that didn't work. And therefore, a lot that I knew about characters that I had tried to bring to the reader, but was unable to do successfully. And therefore, it never really felt done in my mind, especially because both, another thing the two books have in common is that they really are structured around curiosity. Chronology is not an organizing feature. We go forward and backward, the future, the past, but curiosity is the organizing principle of both books. The question really being, having just read X, what would be the most fun thing for the reader to encounter? So my curiosity was certainly still alive about these people when I finished Goon Squad, and actually on my book tour for Goon Squad, I was already working on what became a chapter of The Candy House. And I know that because I write my first drafts by hand, and I still have that draft with guacamole stains on it from the time I was having a Mexican dinner alone while at the Texas Book Festival and working on this thing and dropping guacamole as I drank my tequila. So in a way, the Goon Squad world was never done for me. I wrote a number of drafts for chapters of this book in 2012 and 2013, didn't even type them up. And I write fiction by hand basically because it just comes out better that way if I do that for my first drafts. Put them in a drawer. And then in about 2016, when I finished my last novel, Manhattan Beach, I typed all of it up and thought, okay, so what have we got here? And what we had was, you know, the beginning of something, didn't really know what it was, but I felt interested enough in it still and encouraged by the fact that in a certain way, the world had radically transformed from 2012 to 2016. Obama, Trump, lots of questions about data related to that switch, because another thing that fascinates me about data is that it's so, while it is good at describing things, it is oddly, and good at predicting buying choices, I guess, by humans, terrible at predicting massive events that are critical to all of us. Terrible, didn't predict 9/11, didn't predict Trump's election. He didn't even know he was going to get elected. So why is it that all of this, we've never known more, and yet we can't seem to see things that are in retrospect, absolutely inevitable. And in fact, the data to describe that inevitability was right in our hands. Why? So that also was very interesting to me and even more alive as a concept in 2016 than it had been in 2012. So I continued, and my methodology is really just using time and place as an entry point, and I guess maybe some nostalgia to get me all that sensory detail, entering into a fictional world that feels alive and starting to write. And I write very improvisationally my first drafts, because the thoughts I have consciously about a good idea or a plot are not good enough. Maybe it's groupthink, maybe it's just popular culture consumption that means my ideas are very aligned on a surface level with other people's. That isn't good enough for what I'm trying to do. So I have to get beyond and beneath all of that. And so I just proceeded and in fact, finished during the pandemic. So some of this, in fact, the chapter that I read to you from, I was working on the first draft of that while I had COVID in the New York wave of March 2020. So I was one of those people who was like not feeling too well the day the national lockdown began. And so I, you know, and so I worked on it through all of that.
I feel like you've just given us a masterclass on the idea that every book teaches you to write the book that you just wrote.
100. That is my methodology. And in fact, I'm going to mention that my website, I tried in this new website for this book to lay bare this process a little, because I talked to a lot of fledgling writers and writing students. And part of the challenge for any writer is just to identify one's best process. But if you go to jenniferegan.com and hover over the first chapter of the first page of the first of every chapter is represented as published. And if you hover over the first paragraph, that springs away to show you a marked up manuscript of the same paragraph. And then if you hover again, that springs away to show you the original handwritten draft. And I even have additional layers where I had wrong moves that I had to ultimately throw away before I got to even a workable first draft. To me, it's a pleasure to reveal all that, because I do like to demystify the idea that, you know, a book is somehow this, you know, artifact that is unrelated to human activity. It is deeply related. And, you know, even now, I as I was reading to you guys, I thought I'm going to cut that next time I read. So I'm still editing. But it's really, I like to show those handmade underpinnings of what ultimately feels, you know, like a kind of sealed vessel.
Well, that is marvelous. And it reminds me, you know, speaking of ideas from science fiction getting onto TV, one of my writing teachers was a science fiction writer named Damon Knight, who also wrote a bunch of Twilight Zone episodes, which are hailed for their originality, but which are in fact part of long lineages, like To Serve Man. And Damon told this story about having written a book where he wrote all the parts that he thought were fun. And he was like, I'll go write the boring parts that join them up later. And then he laid the manuscript out on his carpet in piles to figure out what connective tissue he wrote, and then had the revelation that good books don't have boring parts and that he was done. So it really reminds me of your method there, and this business of changing modes from handwritten to typed. I went the other way with a book where I typed it out and then I hand wrote it. And that also was revelatory. And reading aloud, I find, completely changes my relationship to text.
You know, I'm so glad you said that, because I have a tendency not to mention the critical importance for me of a writing group that I work with. I am such a believer in finding a writing community that can help you if one wants that. And I actually dedicated the Candy House to my writing group. Mm-hmm. And one of the signature features about the way we work is that we only read aloud. There's no homework. Wow. There's no scrambling to finish it in time. You read, you have the experience, and there's a natural triage there, because people tend not to get hooked on little, you know, small things that you just don't have time to do that. You're thinking about the big things. And I bring work in at all different phases, including very early, because one of the questions I'm always interested in is just, is it alive? Is it fun, to use the word you used earlier? that's all I care about, believe it or not. I mean, all the good ideas in the world, and I am an idea person. I'm excited by ideas. I like the sense of an intellectual girding in what I read, but that is all worthless if we're not reading a story about people and about whom we care enough to want to know what happens. That's it. That's entertainment.
That's very well said. And, you know, having been in a lot of writers' groups where there's a lot of picking at the small elements of grammar, I'm always reminded that the Finnish word for someone who's nitpicks about grammar is a comma fucker. And it's so perfect. Is there nothing the Finns have not perfected?
Oh my gosh.
I want to go to the two audience questions we have here. And this is your last call. If you've got an audience question, this is your chance. Luna says, what was your inspiration for Lincoln? I love him. I hope the third book, if any, and that's an interesting question, would have more of him. Also Gregory.
Well, it's interesting. I don't have specific inspirations for characters, partly because I'm terrible at writing about people I know, which is a relief to those people, I can tell you. And I also am terrible at writing about myself. I go really cold. And I think the reason is that for me, the fun of writing, the fun, again, back to that word, is that sense of discovery and surprise and entering into a mind that is very different from mine. For example, I love to write from a male point of view because it's an easy way to just feel a separation from my own life. So where Lincoln came from exactly, I couldn't quite tell you, but I think that it's very often following a breadcrumb or a trail of breadcrumbs through my own work. And the initial one was back in Goon Squad when we learn about Sasha very much in passing. There's a quick swoop into the future from the point of view of her uncle, where he remarks that she lives in the desert with two kids, one of whom has like a learning issue. That's all we know. That is like candy for me because of its opacity, because it's so much in passing and because there's no depth to it. My immediate thought is, yeah, but that's a whole life. And my first thought was, what about those kids? And it took me a while to get to them. But when I finally was able to, and oddly enough, through PowerPoint, which, you know, would not have been necessarily the method I would have expected, I found that Lincoln, whom we see through his sister's eyes in that chapter, is, you know, a troubled kid. He and his father have a terrible time together. He's very number oriented. He likes to measure the pauses in rock and roll songs. His father's head is exploding over these long speeches Lincoln gives about the length of the pauses and how they function. But I think it was almost inevitable that on my wish list for Candy House would actually be not only to look through Lincoln's eyes, but to see Lincoln as an adult, because he's so much in transition at that point. And so that was one of the chapters I wrote first. And the time and place, the portal, were again the desert and sort of the tech campus, as I know it, glancingly. And it was, for some reason, a joy to write as Lincoln beyond any I have experienced. And that is the single piece of writing in all of my career at age 59 here, the single piece of writing that has required the fewest drafts to be finished. I think it's only about draft 8. Unheard of for me. I've had as many as 70 drafts of a chapter. 8 is like nothing. So it was amazing to look through Lincoln's eyes, through the eyes of a person obsessed with numbers. And I am here to tell you that as a person who never got beyond trigonometry sophomore year in high school. Go figure.
And what about Gregory?
Gregory, you know, again, Gregory is someone we see very much in passing at the beginning of the Candy House. He's a toddler still nursing and articulately and strongly expressing his wish not to stop nursing. I wanted to revisit Bix Boughton, our inventor, just as I wanted to revisit Sasha in Goon Squad. And my only way to do it, because it doesn't seem to work to write from the same point of view more than once in these books, is through their kids. Gregory was the obvious choice. And it was, again, a real pleasure to find my way into his point of view and to feel again this father-son tension, which in the case of Gregory has to do with his ambivalence and in fact really kind of dislike of all of the technology his father has created. So he embodies this resistance, a kind of visceral resistance to consciousness sharing, which he sees as a threat to fiction writing, which is what he likes to do. So Gregory, in a way, I guess if I had to locate my point of view anywhere in the book, it's probably closest to Gregory's, but it's very tongue in cheek because he's a man in the 20s, 30s, of a mixed race man. We are very different people in terms of our origins. And yet it was a pleasure to find my way to my own point of view in him a little bit.
And how did it feel to have written Bix, who's a very sympathetic character, and then to write Gregory, who reveals all the ways in which he is unsympathetic? I did this with Attack Surface, which is about the person who dislikes the protagonist of the first two books the most, telling her story.
Well, it is just the essence of the fun of point of view shifts, and also a way of looking at the parent-child relationship, which is both so deep and so achingly intense, and yet so limited. You know, we cannot see our parents the way their friends do. It's just not possible. And I think we also don't want to, because the parent-child relationship begins in, you know, infancy with these extreme and iconic roles that can never really be cast off. So it was fun to explore that. I mean, we see Bix in the first chapter slightly resentful of Gregory's unwillingness to stop nursing and objection when Bix suggests that at three he should be stopping. And then to see through Gregory's eyes, to see Bix as, you know, this dad who's giving his life to things that Gregory objects to, and yet all of the love underneath. And that's so often how it is. And one more thing about that, this is oddly, since I never write about myself, I can now say, having discovered it only later, in a way, this whole book is really about my parenting experience. You know, role-playing games are huge in this book, as is baseball. And those are both whole realms of interest that I found my way to through my children. Mm-hmm. So in a little bit in code, this is my memory of and kind of love song to parenthood.
How wonderful. I always think that ambivalence is like the salt in the chocolate that makes it much more tasty. And then before we move on to our last question, Luna did ask about a third book there in passing. Do you know?
You know, I would love it. I here's what I can tell you. My curiosity still exists, and I can feel it kind of pushing away at certain people who are opaque, who seem simplified in various ways in the Candy House and maybe Goon Squad. And there are certain rather extreme structures that I would still like to try. So those elements are there. What's standing in my way is that if you keep following a network into its furthest branches, what you end up with becomes very diffuse. The Candy House is a little more diffuse than Goon Squad, which hopefully is justified by the conceit that we are moving through the collective invasively, inhabiting different points of view. But I don't know that it could get more diffuse than that and still warrant being a book. So that's the technical challenge that I can already see. It would have to narrow in some way. We'll see. I'm open to anything.
Yeah, in Ryan North's brand new book, How to Take Over the World, the last chapter is how to send information forward in time. And he's got like 1 year, 10 years, 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years, 1,000,000,000 years, 10 billion years, 100 billion years. And at the 100 billion mark, he's talking about the heat death of the universe and how many particles would remain. And so it's that idea of like, eventually you reach a breaking point in your diffusion, I think is extremely well illustrated there. So on to our last question here from Maria, who says, in regards to narrative voices, I love the chapter one, the protagonist. What gave you the idea of Chris Salazar narrative? translating all actions into formulas. It was brilliant. Also, my favorite chapter, Lulu the Spy, has disturbing facts narrated like an instruction manual, which is not a question, but a true fact that it is a good chapter and that it is good for those reasons.
Well, so Eye of the Protagonist was a fun one to write. A few things led to it. One was I was very interested in Chris Salazar, the son of Benny Salazar, who is a major character in Goon Squad. And we see Chris as basically a kind of grumpy nine-year-old in Goon Squad. And that's exactly the kind of vision that makes me very curious to revisit that person, especially as, you know, these parental relationships are so important. What we see when Chris is a kid is just resentment of his father, irritation about his parents' divorce. But what we see in the Candy House is certain ways in which Chris ends up resembling his father to some degree. But in I, the Protagonist, Chris is hired by a tech company. He's an English major and a big reader. He's hired by a tech company to create a whole system of algebraic formulas to represent plot tropes, or, you know, plot elements and cliches in contemporary culture. And what he finds is that he starts to actually describe his own life using the same algebra. I do remember the moment that this came to me, which was while watching a very hit mainstream movie, which I'm not going to name, in which I found myself marveling at the fact that every single moment in the movie was a complete cliche. It was a mashup of cliches that was, it was so, at first it was disgusting, but it, in the end, I was mesmerized. I thought, this is like an experiment. I don't think they said, can we actually include every single cliche in the movie making playbook? But that's how it was for me to watch. And I found myself thinking, you could diagram this. This is possibly mathematical. And that, of course, led me to imagine someone who has to do that. And then I, you know, through time and place, found my way into that chapter, which I have to say, I had a lot of fun writing. And one thing I remember is when I first read this chapter to my writing group, I had to bring algebra on pieces of paper to hold up so that they could look at them, because I didn't feel like reading these algebraic equations was really going to be the same as reading aloud, you know, a paragraph of description. So that led to a pretty hilarious session of our writing group.
Yeah, it's like you showed up as cosplaying Julia from 1984 with that wrench and the oil-stained coveralls. Exactly. Coming back from fixing the novel writing machine. Well, that takes us pretty neatly to time here. I want to thank you very much and thank our hosts at the VPL, and also remind the audience that the books are for sale at Book Warehouse. Having a great local independent bookstore in your city is a privilege and not a right. Even big cities like Vancouver can find themselves with few or none of them. And certainly the best way you can thank a writer is to take their books, love their books, share their books with other people, and so on. And those books are very special because they've been signed and now they're non-returnable.
It's been such a pleasure to talk with you, Cory, and thank you, Jorge, for bringing us together. And I will just say, I am a huge lover of and advocate for libraries. I think they help keep our populace reading, which is essential to our mental health, our fun level, and our democracies, in my opinion.
The last place in modern society where you're welcome because you're a person and not because of what's in your wallet. So.
Exactly.
Well, thank you both for such lovely words about libraries and such support. It was a pleasure listening to you talk and dive into these ideas. I'm sure the audience is going to rush to buy these books and or to take them out from the library. So thank you for being here today. Just a quick reminder that the Book Warehouse stores that have signed copies are the Broadway and Main Street stores. So go pay them a visit. Now, if you want to watch this event again, or if you want to share it with your friends, the event was live streamed to the library's YouTube channel so that people can watch it afterwards. I know this is lunchtime in Vancouver, so not everyone can attend at the time that the event happens. So please share with your friends. We're going to share a link to the YouTube playlist where we keep these events. I also have a quick favor to ask of the audience, which is, as a public institution, our job is to program events that work for you and that are interesting to you. So we have a feedback form that we share at every event. It takes about a minute to sign or to fill out. And I promise you that my team takes a look at all your answers and to make sure that, you know, we're delivering the type of programming that is interesting to you. So please fill that out. And then to wrap up, I'm just going to share a couple of the events that we have coming up soon. So we do have events all the time. And tonight we're hosting one that's really special. It's an event about language revitalization with Eden Finde, who's the Indigenous Storyteller in Residence at BPL. So she's going to be chatting about the Cree language revitalization efforts with a woman called Dorothy Visser or Visser. And she's also going to talk about her life before and after attending residential school. So that's tonight at 7 p.m. And then on Thursday, the same week, we're hosting a conversation about the history of Black cowboys and ranchers in Western Canada with filmmaker Cheryl Fogo and writer Bertrand Bickersteth. So it's exciting to be able to put on these events for you. So please attend. I'd love to see you all back together. So I would suggest clicking on those links right now, having those tabs open, and you can register in advance. I'm the kind of person who forgets to register for things. So if I register in advance, I get a reminder and it's really useful for my brain. Anyway, that's it for today. Thank you all for coming. Thank you.
Thanks, Jorge. Thank you, Jennifer. Good luck with the rest of your tour.
Such a pleasure. Thank you all for coming.
Bye. Thank you. See you. We're going to keep the event open just for a couple of minutes or 3 minutes so that people can click on links. Just stay tuned if you want to click on links, but that's it for me. See you. Bye.